Welcome to the Stormsurf Video Surf Forecast for the week starting Sunday, June 17th. Looking at significant wave heights for the South Pacific Ocean, we see a storm generating 44, 45-foot seas or more, but well outside the Southern California swell window. But previously, it was in the window. Seas were much smaller, but some swell has been generated. You can actually see seas from that swell pushing to the north. Another system is southeast of New Zealand, generating 26, 27-foot seas, all aimed off to the east. Likely, no swell is expected from that. But all in all, a bit of a pattern is still occurring, generating some swell, but nothing quite as good as what we've had the past several weeks. As usual, we'll start this week's tour looking at jet stream level winds. These winds up about 30,000 feet help support the formation of gales. When those gales form, help direct their track. We're looking for a trough, that is, the jet pushing to the north, and of course that helps create a clockwise flow, which is the hallmark of low pressure in the South Pacific Ocean. And of course, low pressure generates winds. Winds generate seas. Seas, as they radiate away from the fetch area, turn into swell, and swell, when it hits your beach, creates surf. So we do have a trough, as you can see, over at 100 west. The cutoff for Southern California on systems aimed more or less northeast, it's about 117, something like that. So we're well out of the swell window. But this trough was in the California swell window a few days back. We'll get into that in a minute. Also, there's a weak trough trying to organize here southeast of New Zealand. In fact, we saw that there is some seas being generated by surface low pressure supported by this trough. The ice line's right down around 65. So this is on the hairy edge of being mainly over Antarctica. So let's roll this out, take a look what's to happen. As we see, of course, as we get into Monday, the trough in the east, well gone by then. The trough in the southwest actually turns into a full-grown low-pressure system, but its position is rather suspect. But of more interest is a trough forecast to develop south of New Zealand this evening, basically Sunday evening, being fed by 140 to almost 150 knot winds. Looking pretty good there. Let's see. There it goes. It sort of pushes north, and it actually starts sucking some of this low pressure that was ahead of it up into it, still supporting low pressure development down at the surface. Continuing winds, 130 as we get into Tuesday. So offering some hope there. Then still, look at this. It's just full-on, continued circulating upper-level low-pressure system. The question is, what's that going to do now at the surface? Now, notice winds here in the all-important west quadrant start weakening as we get into Wednesday evening, and then the system's pretty much gone after that. Still well-organized trough, but no real winds in the west quadrant, so probably nothing to result from that. And then as we get into Friday night, everything kind of fades out. Notice this large ridge that is doing the opposite of trough, pushing south. That creates high pressure aloft, certainly not good for swell production. Roll this out further. We see, hey, here's another trough starting to develop maybe on Sunday. Let's see what it does. Looking better, offering some hope as we go 180 hours out. So, moderate hope. You know, we've actually had a pretty good pattern here going for several weeks now. Been a good flurry of consistent southern hemi swells. Wouldn't be surprising if things back off a little bit. But right now, it might back off some, but it doesn't look like it's completely shutting down. So let's go take a look down at the surface. Surface level pressure, surface level winds. And remember, we know there's a trough way over here. Sure enough, a little bit of a gale, 45 knot winds, targeting mainly, see that? Aimed from the west to the east, targeting mainly southern Chile. Probably not anything generating even, let's say, Mexico, minimal for Peru, probably. There is a good fetch of 35 knot winds there. But anyway, all that aside, here's the one we're more interested in. What is that? So the ice line's right around here. So a bit of fetch, but the good core stuff down here was that 50 knot winds. All over Antarctic ice, we suspect, so no hope there. A little tiny fetch of 45-knot winds, mainly 40-knot winds. Let's see what that does over time. Yeah, into Sunday night, and then it all sort of turns zonal, aimed off to the east. But this system is what we probably want to look at, and other systems coming behind it. Tiny little area, 50-knot winds as we get into Monday, aimed to the north there, and continuing, but weaker. And then really kind of not particularly organized. This system a few days ago was looking very strong. Now it's pretty anemic, if anything. Secondary system forecast to develop under New Zealand on Tuesday with 35 to 40 knot winds, building to 40 to 45 knots as we get into Tuesday night into Wednesday. Looking stronger there, and more fetch right behind that, lifting well to the north, 35 to 40 knots into Wednesday night, into Thursday, into Thursday night, and then fading out. Now, the issue here is 35 knot winds generally get you about a 13, 14 second period swell. That does not survive very well the long journey up into California. Certainly better for Tahiti in that area, maybe even for Hawaii, but 13, 14 second period swell, you really need 40 knot winds minimum. We saw some of that. So we'll take a look at the wave model chart, see what results. Then that all falls apart as we get into Friday and Saturday and Sunday. And then that's it. We know there's a new trough building here. This is actually the 06Z run of the model. I know the newer run of the model is going to run here in just a little bit, but we suspect that this low will build maybe a little bit stronger than what is forecast here, but that's a week out, so who knows? Wouldn't believe the models a week into the future anyway. All right, let's go take a look at the wave models. So we're going to go back in time a little bit, and as you notice, there's this cutoff gale here. This was a week ago, well, actually Saturday night a week ago, June 10th. Yeah, we'll see right about there. We'll pull away. You can see underneath the controls. There we go. 28-foot seas, 29-foot seas aim north. Swell from this system right here is actually hitting California right now. It also made it into Hawaii 2 days ago or so. Nice little swell hit the Hawaiian Islands, but that's fading now. California, just starting to show up. Southern California, there were some head-high sets. And in Northern California, this morning it was, you know, occasional sets in the shoulder high range, something like that. Maybe a peak at the very best spot to head high. But, you know, take what you can get. There are waves. Anyway, roll this out. That system faded out. Should make swell into Tuesday, something like that. And then it starts fading out. Roll this out. And then really nothing behind that. Just keep going here if the computer will respond. There we go. Then this system, this was Thursday night. This is a system that started developing in the Southeast Pacific. 29-foot seas in the California swell window. Certainly, and aimed kind of northeast. It's better if it's aimed north when it's this far in the East Pacific, but you take what you can get. Seas to 30 feet as we got into Friday morning, then fading out, moving out of the swell window just after that. But then a secondary pulse developed Friday night. A little bit of 28-foot seas building to 32 feet. Now, this was aimed more off to the east, so less energy probably from that. And then by Saturday morning, those seas look good. Was that 30, 32, 34, maybe 35 feet? It says 36 feet, maybe over a tiny little area, but on average 34 to 35 feet, we'll say. But it's right on the hairy edge of the Southern California swell window. All looks like it's aimed towards Peru, Chile, probably not a whole lot by that time, going to California, and then it's building, but out of the swell window, so of no real concern. And that gets us where we are today. Current setup, watching this system, southeast of New Zealand, 29, 32-foot seas, but again, remember, most of this is aimed off to the east. Kind of doubtful anything of any real significance is going to result from it. This guy here, southeast of New Zealand, on Monday afternoon, what's that, 34-foot seas? Yeah, just barely, tiny little fetch area, and fading and dissipating pretty quick. The secondary system develops behind it, 28-foot seas into Wednesday morning, building a little bit more to 32 or 33 feet, something like that. And lifting northeast. So this is probably good, assuming it forms for swell, certainly for Tahiti and surrounding islands, also for Hawaii, and probably for California, but though it's more than likely behind the Tahitian swell shadow. And then it too fades out and is pretty much gone. But still, at the way things are going, you take whatever you can get. There's energy. There's something going on. It'll create some small swell, something rideable. The whole point here, or at least our strategy, is avoid wind swell. Go for a real longer period swell if you can. But at least we know there is wind swell in the forecast, at least for a bit. Anyway, rolling out into Sunday, small system in the Tasman Sea, 30-foot seas. Probably, if that were to develop, might make some background pulse for Fiji, but nothing probably for Hawaii. It's just not big enough. And then here's the new trough forecast to develop in this area. We'll see what it does. We're at 180 hours out. Never believe a model this far, much less 2 weeks out. Pretty much our cutoff or our belief for cutoff is about 3 to 4 days out. If it's there, at the 96-hour mark, then maybe it'll develop. Anything after that, pure voodoo, pure fantasy, don't believe it. So let's take a look long-term. Of course, what's going on with the Madden-Julian Oscillation, and of course, La Niña or El Niño. Guess we'll see. As usual, we like to look for the presence of the active phase of the MJO. And the way we do that is, one of the ways, at least, is looking for wind anomalies from the west in the West Pacific. So, here we go. This is TAO buoy data array. This is the equator. East Pacific here. West Pacific here. That's New Guinea there. So these are a series of buoys strung across the equator, used normally for monitoring the presence of El Nino or La Nina. But also, they have wind sensors on them, so you can look at wind speed, wind direction. This is a five-day average wind, so it's not like a regular NOAA buoy or CDIP buoy off the California or Florida, the U.S. East Coast. Just sort of average winds over a five-day period, looking to be out of the east, which is trades, but much weaker over what we call the Kelvin Wave Generation area, that area from 170 west off to about 135 east. 5 degrees north and south of the equator, draw a box here, and this is where, if you have westerly anomalies, winds blowing from the west or trades just much weaker than normal, you can actually get warm water, and you see this 30 degree isotherm here, 29, this is your water temperatures, these numbers, 30 degrees centigrade, that's warm water. If trades slack here, these warm waters will fall to depth and start moving off to the east, creating what's known as a Kelvin wave. And when that Kelvin wave erupts off of the Galapagos and Ecuador, can create a warm water patch on the ocean surface. And that, of course, can feed El Nino, or certainly, if nothing else, feed the jet stream. So, looking at anomalies, differences from normal for this time of year. Look at this, westerly anomalies in the far east Pacific. Now, that's not going to get you a Kelvin wave or anything, but that's easterly anomalies, if anything, create upwelling. It's the westerly anomalies back here that we were interested in. Sorry about that. So, a little bit of westerly anomalies building. Yeah, from about the dateline over to about 140. Now, we know water temperatures are warming here, too, and there's some other stuff going on. We'll get to that in a minute. But back in the Kelvin Wave Generation area, pretty much normal. Neutral winds, not westerly, not easterly, so it's not going to create a Kelvin Wave, but it's not going to suppress, just kind of a neutral pattern. And then we can look at wind anomalies in the Kelvin Wave Generation area the past couple of days. There's New Guinea there. There's the equator right there. South America, Australia, so the Kelvin Wave Generation area, roughly, starting right about there. Just draw a box right in there. So that's the area we're looking to look for the presence of the active phase of the MJO. Of course, the active phase of the MJO helps impart wind or energy to the jet stream, and of course, the jet stream is what helps support gale formation. So if you have the active phase of the MJO, sometimes in the summer, it helps support storm formation down here. More direct correlation in winter months, specifically in the Gulf of Alaska and the North Dateline region. Anyway, so kind of a neutral broken up pattern here, June 11th, and you can kind of just look down through these images here, a little bit of a building westerly wind pattern or westerly anomaly pattern in the Kelvin Wave Generation area, but nothing too strong, a little bit better as of June 15th, but not directly right on the equator, mainly north of the equator. Still kind of suspicious here and maybe not a bad thing. So from the GFS model, zonal wind anomalies, these are up about 850 millibars, about 4,700 feet up in the air. Good proxy for what's going on down at the ocean surface. Blues are easterly anomalies, meaning the inactive phase of the MJO. And it's really between these two tick marks here that we're looking, and you just go straight down the page. So that suggests the inactive phase of the MJO, but that was back in late May. So we got into June, still easterly anomalies, but sort of pockets of westerly anomalies trying to get organized. But then here we are, June 17th, easterly anomalies still in the Kelvin Wave Generation area, in the bulk of it. But right on the dateline, there's this patch of westerly anomalies. It was actually supposed to be stronger and last longer. It kind of looks now to be fading out a week from now. So probably not a whole lot of anything going on. This still very much looks like hangover from La Nina, or a neutral pattern bias towards La Nina. We say that because, well, we have been in La Nina the past year and a half or whatever it's been. And also, too, with La Nina, even if La Nina is not present, cool waters are not present in the Nino regions in the over the equatorial East Pacific. If you've been in that pattern for a year and a half, it's not going to, you know, if the water temperature is warm, it doesn't mean that instantly the atmosphere above it's going to change. It's a three-month transition. We're figuring around August 8th, August 10th, something like that. That's when the transition will start. So based on this, it still looks like La Nina's in the atmosphere, even though we know from, you know, from we were doing this every week from previous reports that some sort of neutral pattern is trying to set up in the ocean. So next, trying to dig into more, trying to understand what's going on with the MJO, looking at outgoing long wave radiation, that is, yellows and oranges are more sunlight reflectivity off the ocean's surface, meaning high pressure, meaning no clouds, meaning the inactive phase of the MJO. The statistic model suggests the inactive phase of the MJO is to build through the next for the next week and then fade, while the active phase of the MJO, blue here, less sunlight reflectivity, meaning more clouds, is supposed to sort of hold or develop some here in the Indian Ocean. Looking at the dynamic model, the GEFS model, it's saying basically the same thing, only the inactive phase holding for the next 2 weeks while the active phase remains bottled up in the Indian Ocean. This is not favorable for storm development, and this might explain why we're seeing a decrease in storm production forecast by the models in the South Pacific Ocean. Phase diagram charts, another way of tracking the active phase of the MJO. This circle, assume you're looking down on the North Pole. The MJO, of course, travels from west to east from the Indian Ocean, over the maritime continent, over the West Pacific, over the Dateline, under the United States, across the Atlantic, through North Africa, back to the Indian Ocean, continues to make this cycle. The heavy dot is where the active phase is right now, so where's that? Somewhere probably over the Atlantic, we'll say, or maybe even pushing into Africa, probably over North Africa, actually. And if it's inside this circle, it's considered to be extremely weak. The forecast, you can see the active phase just kind of meandering around somewhere in the Indian Ocean, 2 weeks out, extremely weak, which probably means on the opposite side of the planet over here, the inactive phase will be in control. Same thing, basically, for the GEFS model. Having the active phase weak, noodling around in the Indian Ocean, and not doing anything with the inactive phase, probably here in the West Pacific. The one-month CFS model now paints a little bit different picture, but here we go. Kelvin wave generation area between these two tick marks. You can see what's gone on the past. The heavy line, so dotted lines of the inactive. Here's the active. We're back in May there. Inactive mid-May. Active in the June timeframe. So we're supposedly just coming out of the active phase of the MJO per this model. And there is some sort of incredibly weak inactive phase forecast for the next, these are 1 week increments, 2 weeks, probably 3 weeks per this. The blue is easterly anomalies. Now this is the interesting part. On the dateline, you can see here, westerly anomalies forecast. And we saw them, we've seen them, and they're there. Not really in the heart of the Kelvin wave generation area, but sort of just setting up right on the dateline. So this is the low-pass filter suggesting a bias towards low pressure, which one could construe almost as maybe a development of El Nino, though we don't really want to say it. But assuming this to be the case, if this is where the heart of El Nino is, it's actually kind of displaced off to the east just a hair bit. You know, normally when an El Nino is developing, the low pressure bias would be right here in the heart of the Kelvin wave generation area, generating westerly anomalies like this here and creating Kelvin waves. Now the question is, how well is, if westerly anomalies continue right on the dateline, is that sufficiently in enough in the Kelvin wave area enough to produce Kelvin waves? And the answer is maybe. Hard to say. The cutoff of the Kelvin wave generation area in our experience is about somewhere right about here, 170 west. But you can see here, so basically west anomalies filling from 150 to 150 east to 170 west. So maybe we'll see. What is that? 30 degrees. That's 1800 nautical miles. Probably, but hard to say. Let's keep going. And then the upper level model. So this goes out 40 days, okay? And this is areas favorable for precipitation. Greens are favorable for precipitation, yellows not. So one could say active phase of the MJO, inactive phase of the MJO. So here we are today. You see this sort of a, this consistent yellow pattern moving off to the east. We can assume that's a very weak, unorganized, inactive phase of the MJO tracking across the Pacific through about mid-July. And then a active phase is developed in the West Pacific. There's New Guinea right there going across the Pacific, making it to the mid-Pacific in late July sort of time frame. And this model runs about a week ahead of what goes on at the surface. So basically, all these models are saying inactive phase right now or developing, and we won't see another active phase for probably 3 to 4 weeks, something like that. So, and all that actually correlates pretty well with what we're seeing on the wave models and everything else, sort of a back off of the swell pattern. And we could attribute that perhaps to the inactive phase of the MJO. One more model to look at now. The 3 month CFS model, 850 millibar winds. So past performance is here. The future's up top. One can notice, and Kelvin wave generation area, basically in this area. So you just go right up the chart. You go from there to there, and what do you see? See lots of yellows, lots of oranges, suggesting building westerly anomalies long term. But right now, here's where we are, June 17th. Westerly anomalies forecast on the dateline. Okay, and there's our patch of easterly anomalies over the west Kelvin wave generation area. Let's overlay the MJO. So this suggests we're in a fading active phase of the MJO. The dotted contours are the inactive phase of the MJO, moving from west to east over time, time going this way. And so we're pretty much in sync. This active phase kind of seems a bit overhyped on this chart. We're not seeing it at the surface as much as this suggests. But the inactive phase, either way, starting, what's that? Oh, by about June 22nd or so. So what's that? 5 days from now, inactive phase in control. Yeah, it's about in sync. But notice easterly anomalies from it limited to, where's that cutoff? That's about 140 east. That's not very much. And this suggests building westerly anomalies on the dateline and then actually retrograding, backfilling into the heart of the Kelvin wave generation area as we get about into mid-July. And that's what we see in all the other models, is inactive phase going for about a month. And then all heck's supposed to break loose in terms of a strong active phase of the MJO, strong westerly anomalies. If this were to occur, that certainly could help produce another Kelvin wave. That would be a good thing, especially if you're looking to build some sort of El Nino pattern. But again, I'm not going to believe a model that's telling me what's going on in the August time frame when we're in mid-June. So that's 6 weeks out or more. But still, nice little tease. The model's been consistently saying this, so, and it hasn't really wavered. So that's a good thing. Okay, low-pass filter. Here we go. So this is the area, the low pressure bias in the atmosphere. We talked about that. Holding, what is that, about 150, 145 west, basically filling the Kelvin wave generation area. Two contours as of right now, building to three as we get into July. This certainly smells like a pattern that's very El Niño-ish like, not strong, but certainly not La Niña. In fact, the dotted contour is the high pressure bias, and that is what has been in control. It's now moving off to the east. It's basically over California, and as we get into September, it's supposed to be inland over California. This suggests a low pressure bias filling the Pacific. That would be great if it happens. I'm not believing it yet, but it's a step in the right direction. And just a quick look here, strength of the active phase of the MJO. Not giving you any indication of where, just pure strength. So 2015, we were in El Nino. You can see these big spikes up here of the active phase of the MJO. Those were generating Kelvin waves, westerly wind bursts, et cetera, et cetera. Into January 16, a little bit at a time, things just slowly petered out. You got into late fall, January 2016, MJO really weak. One little pulse there in January, but just, and then dead last summer. And notice, there wasn't a whole lot of southern hemi activity. And really, it started waking up This was this big active phase of the MJO in February. It created a Kelvin wave. We've talked about this for multiple weeks. We'll get into that in a minute. And then another pulse and yet another pulse. Here we are right now, suggesting we're coming off the active phase of the MJO, moving towards the inactive phase. But notice the preponderance or the density of the active phases are far exceeding those of the inactive phase. We're back here. The inactive phase dominated and the active phase was more sporadic. This tends to suggest that we are moving towards a more favorable pattern for storm development. All right, so much for the MJO. Right now, we know we're moving into an inactive period, and so we're just going to have to live with that for a couple of weeks. But what's going on in the ocean? This helps set us up for the longer-term discussion. El Nino, La Nina, that sort of thing. Warm water in the far west Pacific. This is actually, from the TAO buoy ray. Again, our series of buoys. These are the anchor lines on the buoys strung across the equatorial Pacific. This just on the equator, 2 degrees north to south. Okay, the X's are the sensors on the buoy array. You can see some of the sensors are working, some of them not. This is kind of how things go. It's just too many thousand miles of open ocean to have a boat out there all the time fixing every little sensor, you know, managing everything. So what you end up doing is you have a model that tries to interpolate and fill the gaps. This model suggests here is the profile, 28 degree isotherms. No, this is the big deal, 28 degree centigrade. This previously was back at 180, held there for months and months, typical of La Nina. Why? Well, of course, if La Nina, you have strong easterly wind, stronger than normal, keeps all the warm water balled up in the far west Pacific. Those westerly anomalies have backed off, right? We had a big westerly wind burst in February, got a Kelvin wave moving off to the east. We'll get into that in a second. So anyway, what we see is the 28-degree isotherm starting to move to the east. The big deal here is last week it was at 160. So even 2 months ago, it was at 180. It's moved to about 160. It stalled there for about a week. Now it's on the move again to 155 west. This is good news, suggesting warm water moving east. Of course, the 24-degree isotherm actually getting a little bit deeper here off of Ecuador. What is that, about 35, 40 meters deep? So warm water definitely on the move. So what's the deal here? Okay, we look at anomalies, differences from normal for this time of year. Why? Well, we have warm water pushing at depth off to the east. So for those of you that haven't been through this drill before, when you get the active phase of the MJO and it's strong enough, you get westerly anomalies here in the West Pacific. Warm water that's been balled up here starts on the move. It falls to depth and travels as a big bubble the whole way across under the equator, across the Pacific, then hits the Galapagos and Ecuador and starts erupting to the surface, creating a warm water slick. If you get enough westerly wind bursts, meaning enough active phases of the MJO, and enough Kelvin waves, then that creates a semi-permanent pool of warm water here in the East Pacific. That is the hallmark of El Nino. And what's the big deal about El Nino? Yeah, we all know it creates waves, but how does it do that? What it's doing is it's imparting energy to the jet stream, pushing the jet stream further south over the North Pacific, or further north in the South Pacific, okay, and puts the focus of energy squarely in the central, you know, like in the Gulf, Western Gulf of Alaska, North Dateline region, the North Pacific, and amplifies the storm pattern in southern months just east and southeast of New Zealand. So we have a strong Kelvin wave. It appears to be starting to erupt on the surface. This is good news. The point being, we need another one. Remember now, we saw the models predicting a good active phase of the MJO in the August time frame. If that happens, then theoretically we'd get another Kelvin wave and more warm water buildup. So the point of all that is, well, we have cool water in the East Pacific fading right now, the remnants of La Nina. We want to get rid of La Nina completely. I think this guy's going to do it if it hadn't done it already. But if you want to go a step further and really start amplifying the jet stream and setting us up for the fall and winter months for a above average season, then we need more Kelvin waves. Here's a different take on the subsurface water profile, just a different model using the same data as the above. But what this suggests is there's our initial Kelvin wave, right? Right there. Good, what's that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, a pocket of maybe 4 degree anomalies, a couple of pockets of those. The other cool thing is here, right here. So what's that? 140 west. The water's warm water erupting to the surface between about 100 west to 140. So just write that down. Keep that in the back of your mind. When we go look at ocean surface temps, we'll see if that's actually happening. Now, the other thing that's interesting here is another blob of warm water has shown up just in the past couple days. And if you look at this in time-lapse mode, if you go to our site and look at this page, you'll see it. It's actually falling at depth here. This would be basically east, northeast of New Guinea, that sort of frame. This is warm water that we believe is seeping out of the waters in the maritime continent. There are some channels there that if you get westerly anomalies, so when the active phase of the MJ moves from the Indian Ocean, if it holds together and starts moving over the maritime continent, it actually can squeeze warm water out of that area right on the equator, lots of warm water there, and squeeze it into the Pacific. And that's really where a lot of this warm water comes from. It's not generated in the Pacific per se. It's all balled up in the area Pacific, north of New Guinea, and then north of the Bali area, if you want to go that way. So we see seepage occurring here. The question is, will it build up enough? Will we get a westerly anomalies? And will it create yet another Kelvin wave? I don't know. And this is just one model's view, so it's a minority view, minority opinion. But looking favorable, certainly not cold water. There's the last little drop of cool water associated with La Nina there, and then here. But this is basically considered neutral water, so this is looking much better. Sea level anomalies, okay. So positive sea level anomalies. This is JSON 2 satellite data. Strip out all the wind waves, strip out the swell, strip out the tides. And you just see basically a bump on the ocean surface, 5 centimeters. 10 centimeters, but it's this area 5 degrees north and south of the equator. Just go right across here like that. That's one just interesting. What this means is warm water at depth. Remember, we were talking about water seeping out through west of the Kelvin wave generation here. You get that sense that that's happening here, falling to depth. It sort of congregates here. You get a westerly wind burst, and that creates a Kelvin wave and then pushes it the rest of the way across the Pacific. So what we do see is piles of warm water at depth, completely spanning the equator from one side of the Pacific to the other. That's South America right there, the Galapagos right there. So suggesting strongly that a Kelvin wave is in flight. Upper ocean heat anomalies, upper 300 meters of the ocean, west Pacific here, east Pacific here, time going down. So last year, August 2017, there's our La Nina cool pool. We've done this before. We won't get into it too much. Tiny little Kelvin wave. You can see warm water, the oranges and the yellow reds here, working their way across the Pacific, pretty much dissipated. The Kelvin wave didn't really make it the whole way across the Pacific, but what it did do was cut the legs out of La Nina. Then you get this upwelling phase of the Kelvin wave cycle. Then you get another large westerly wind burst in February, large Kelvin wave pushing east, but it stalled at about 115 west, sat there for a month, something like that. On the move now, moving off to the east, you can see it clearly. So all this data confirms Kelvin wave is in flight. What's the impact on the ocean surface? That's what really matters, because it's up at the surface that then, if water's warm there, that can affect the atmosphere above it in a positive direction. So here we are, sea surface temperature anomalies, differences from normal for this time of year. Along Peru, we have some upwelling here, a bit stronger than usual, or a bit stronger than it's been. The blues suggesting cooler waters. That's pretty normal. You get strong south winds along here. That's trades for this area causing upwelling. Basically the same thing as strong north winds in northern California, central California, that also creates upwelling. So we see that. But and then here, notice reds, oranges, the whole way from the Galapagos to almost the dateline there, so why we assume it keeps going from there. Not super strong, but clearly no sign of La Nina here. If La Nina was here, you'd see these blues. You don't see any of that. You see this is the last fading pool of La Nina, and really there's 5 degrees south. I think there's more warm water than cool water. So the main Nino, there's Nino 1.2, which is kind of this area right off in here. Nino 3.4, which is the main El Nino monitoring region from 120 west, 5 degrees north and south of the equator, out to 170, so out in there. Sure, it certainly looks like a good amount of warm water building. Nothing off over the charts, but certainly not a hint of La Nina left anymore. That's good news, because what that means, remember we saw this building kind of active phase of the MJO pattern and low pressure bias on the dateline and all that kind of stuff starting 3 months out? Well, this looks like it's supporting that picture, that is warming in this area. And once the ocean starts warming, then that in turn starts a feedback loop that helps support more westerly anomalies in the Kelvin wave generation area, that supports Kelvin waves being generated, that pushes more warm water to the east, it erupts on the surface, and you get this feedback loop, and it goes until basically there's no more warm water left in the West Pacific to make it this way, and then the whole thing collapses, and then you go back to La Nina or some flavor of La Nina. Sea surface temperature trend the past 7 days, yeah, little pockets warming along the Galapagos, slight cooling off of Peru. And it was warmer out in this area 2 days ago. Now, all this means is it's kind of the daily ebb and flow, kind of very noisy data. You can't read too much into it. Clearly see hurricane tracks up here along the Mexico coast causing upwelling. That does not mean that, you know, some sort of La Nina pattern. That's a short-term trend. That just as easily can turn warm in another week or two as the sun starts baking the ocean surface. Of course, warming up here along Hawaii, etc. But really, it's this area down here on the equator that we're interested in. And then the overview pattern. So, one note, off Africa last week, we saw cool anomalies out here. And typically when that starts blowing here, suggests sort of easterly anomalies. And it sort of manifests itself here off of Ecuador and the Galapagos. And that's still kind of happening, but it's collapsed off of Africa. The thought is whatever this cooling is here will also collapse in maybe the next 4 to 5 days, something like that. But of far more interest, here is our tiny, tiny little building warm pool, Nino 3.4 region, 120 west out to 170 west, so right in here. In general, warmer temperatures in terms of an El Nino, not even close right now, but it certainly is no La Nina at all. So I think we're done with La Nina, and that's the really good news. Now the question is, where do we go from here? A little bit early to tell, but let's go take a look at ocean surface temperatures. Here's the daily index for the Nina 1.2 region, that area off of Peru and the Galapagos. Yeah, we've seen temperatures drop off. It's down to negative 1.335 degrees. Yeah, and that seems about right, but let's go take a look at the all-important Nina 3.4 region. So here we go. You can see clearly in this region the trend has been steadily upwards. We went positive about a week ago, something like 6 days ago, and we were up about plus 0.35, 0.4, something like that, down today, down to just a tenth, 0.14 degrees above normal. But this is the first time the temperatures have been above the neutral line for a year or something like that. So, suggesting that La Nina, if it isn't dead, it's pretty darn close to dead, and that's good news, because if we get into the neutral range, then the atmosphere will start responding in kind. La Nina will fade out of the atmosphere, and the net effect is increased in storm production. And the thought is, if we're neutral now, probably take another 2 months or so, June to July to August, somewhere in late August, maybe the southern hemisphere will wake up a bit. But what this speaks more to is the North Pacific for the fall season. Certainly, it should be more normal and a lot stronger storm pattern than what we had last winter. So what's going on in the atmosphere above the equator where the warm water is building up? Well, right now we look at a southern oscillation index, difference in pressure between Darwin, Australia and Tahiti. When the index is negative over a long period of time, that suggests either the active phase of the MJO or maybe El Nino. When it's positive, that means higher pressure over Tahiti, meaning the inactive phase of the MJO. So right now, daily number, minus 21, that suggests the active phase of the MJO, but that's noisy. You can see these numbers jump around. We were pretty, what we'd say, inactive, trying to go active right now. We saw on the one model, yeah, we're in the active phase, but it's supposed to fade here pretty quick, so we're not going to get too excited. 30-day average, yeah, it's negative. Hey, that's good news. We haven't seen that in quite a while. And looking back here, yeah, we did get a good active phase back here. So it's turning negative, minus 0.53. That's not doing a whole lot. But the 90-day average, that's what you can use for monitoring El Nino, La Nina. It's been consistently, you can see, fives positive down to 1.98 now. We want to see this go to zero. So what this says is, though ocean surface temperatures are warming, the atmosphere hasn't quite picked up on it. Yeah, it's picking up that things are getting better, but it hasn't fully responded. It's going to take another 2 months, something like that. So we're on track. This seems about normal. ESPI index, basically the same sort of index, only it measures the difference in precipitation between the area north of Darwin, Australia, and Tahiti. And really what you want to see is you want to see positive anomalies. And right in here, and what that means is you're getting more precipitation in normal here in like the Nino 3.4 region, right? And what that means is you got to have warm water in here. And warm water, of course, supports evaporation. And evaporation, of course, condenses into clouds, and clouds produce rain. So right now, our index is minus 0.55, meaning it's a little bit drier in this area than normal. And you can kind of see that just looking right up here. Yeah, rainfall anomalies the last 30 days. And it's just 5 degrees north and south of the equator, right in there. So, but you know what? We were down at minus 0.9, I think it was last week, something like that. And this steadily, if you graphed it out, is steadily inching its way towards normal. We still think it's going to be another 6 weeks or so till we get to a really good place, 6 to 8 weeks, something like that. But we're making the turn. That's good news. And just going back real quick, the 30-day SOI average graphed out, you can see it. Here was our El Nino back in 2016 fading, our La Nina, positive anomalies, though it still had negative its negative moments, but for the most part, positive since past 2 years roughly until now. Almost looks like maybe we're starting to move towards a more neutral pattern, something like that. So all this data correlates reasonably well, but you got to look at a lot of data and know what you're looking at to try to tie all the pieces together. And then finally, sea surface temperature forecast from the CFS model for the Nino 3.4 region, the official El Nino monitoring region. Here we are. Let's see. We are June, let's say mid-June, so that's April, May, June. We're probably somewhere around in here. This suggests we should be at about plus 0.2 degrees. And we're probably a little bit behind that, but not too far. This is an idealized view. The forecast suggests continued warming. As we get into July, maybe 0.45 degrees above normal. As we get into October, 0.95 degrees above normal. Anything above this line for a long period of time is considered weak El Nino. If you're into 1 degree to, this is what, 1.1, something like that in this region, the whole way through winter, that would be a modest to moderate El Nino sort of scenario. That would be good. We don't expect that to happen. I mean, but many of the other models are saying the same thing too. The only reason we say we don't expect it is because it's too far in the future and we just tend to be pessimistic. I'd rather not get too excited, and I don't like disappointment. So it's better to just sort of say, well, believe it when we see it. And if it does happen, hey, then you're in there, you know, rather than get yourself all worked up into a lather over it and then it doesn't materialize and it just sort of, you know, doesn't work out well. So better to be conservative in that regard. So, but this is on track. The model has consistently been suggesting this now. Other models are saying the same thing. We're waiting for the consensus model to update. It normally does it somewhere around mid to late June, and then we'll present that data to you when it's made available. So to wrap things up, small southern hemiswell hitting California. It's pretty much gone for Hawaii now. Maybe some small, and we're talking small is the operative word, more swell to work its way up into California and Hawaii, but nothing off the charts. Inactive phase, the MJO, expect to build for the next 3 to 4 weeks. So the storm cycle should be fairly quiet for a while. But if we can get through that as we get into late July sort of time frame, the expectation is the active phase of the MJO starts building and the storm cycle starts building. And of course, beyond that, we have Kelvin wave erupting. That's supposed to continue. La Nina is gone. Maybe El Nino developing. All the data suggests that at least a normal storm pattern as we get into the later part of summer, that'll help the southern hemisphere some, and certainly as we move into fall, a little bit more vigorous storm track for the North Pacific for the coming fall and winter, and that is good news. And also, the thought is a normal precipitation outlook for the Sierra and California in general. So that's it for this week. We'll do it again next week, same time, same channel. Thanks for watching.